Welcome to First Church Online. The psalmist writes and he says, when they said, let's go to the house of God, my heart leaped for joy. And now we're here, O Jerusalem, inside Jerusalem's walls. I know many of you are looking forward to a time that we can get together back as a church, united and worshiping together. You know, more and more is being said about regathering these days. And I like to think of it in terms of regathering the church rather than reopening the church. Because, you know, the church never really closed. The church is still going on because the church is you representing Christ wherever you are. Now, we're expected to move to phase three this coming Friday. In fact, by the time many of you watch this, we will be in phase three as a state. And according to my understanding of that, that means groups of no larger than 10 can get together. So it's probably going to be a little bit longer before we can meet together regularly on Sunday mornings. Our elders are meeting. In fact, I'm meeting with them today. This is Wednesday when I'm doing this, to talk about our regathering strategy. And at some point, we will share with you what we have put together as far as how we can meet together again. We want to resume as soon as we possibly can, but we're going to work in harmony with the state guidelines, and safety is going to be paramount in our meeting together. So we ask you to continue to pray and support the work of the church and to be the church wherever you happen to be. So today I want to talk to you about, we're going to go back to a series that I started back at the first of the year. We didn't get a chance to finish it up with the arrival of the coronavirus, but rethinking our thoughts. Paul talks in Romans chapter 12, verse 2, about renewing our minds. And many times we don't know really what that even means. And so today we're going to look at the importance of renewing your words. In The Secret Life of Pronouns, James Pennebaker, who has spent years researching the significance of our words, with a team of graduate students, he developed a computer program that analyzes what our words say about us. Based on his research, Pennebaker claims that the words we speak over our lifetime are like fingerprints. Even small words broadcast the kind of people that we are. He says our words sort of act like powerful tools to excavate people's thoughts and feelings, motivations, and relationships with each other. Our words reveal the condition of our heart. Your words reveal what's most deeply inside of you. And so that means your words matter. What you say has significance. What rolls off your tongue comes straight from your heart. Your thoughts turn into words, and they come out of your heart into the heart and mind of everybody else who hears you speak. If you're going to speak more like Jesus, you have to think like Jesus. He said it this way. He said, what goes into a man's mouth does not make him unclean, but what comes out of his mouth, that is what makes him unclean. Don't you see that whatever enters the mouth goes into the stomach, and then out of the body? But the things that come out of the mouth come from the heart. This is what makes a man unclean. For out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false testimony, slander. Jesus says, these are the things that make a man unclean. And so the food that you eat, you know, it's going to be digested, and it's going to come out as waste. You eat it and it gets used up or it's gone. But the things that come out of your mouth come from what's in your heart. And that's far more important than the food that you eat. Because what comes out of your mouth lasts. And it needs to concern you much more than what goes into your mouth. In the very beginning of the Bible are the words, "Then God said." I mean, this is repeated several times. And by the power of his word, everything was created. Later he says in Isaiah, for as the rain and snow come down from the heaven and do not return without watering the earth, making it bare and sprout, and providing seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so will my word be which goes out of my mouth. It will not return to me void, or useless, or without result, without accomplishing what I desire, and without succeeding in the matter for which I sent it. God's spoken word always accomplishes something. It's not empty, void, or without results. It's not spoken in vain. God's word is always fulfilled. And you know, it's no different with us. God gave us an amazing ability to express ourselves. Unlike any other creature or animal, we can verbalize our hearts and our minds. Our words come from our inner thoughts and our attitudes. What we say is not empty or without result either. It accomplishes the purpose for which we spoke it. But our speech, you know, is not always like God's. In fact, just before God talks in Isaiah about how the rain and the snow come down from heaven and water the earth, he says this. He says, "My thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways." Our 21st century world, it seems to be blaring with irresponsible and hurtful words of all kinds. You know, we used to depend upon our leaders to set a good example for the rest of us. But more and more, they show us how not to speak and act. People use foul language without even giving it a second thought. There's widespread lying, slander, shaming, ridiculing. You know, trash talk used to be confined to sports, but now it seems to be going on everywhere and about everybody. Hateful words are used daily to cyberbully people on the internet. We can say things without even thinking or considering the impact it's going to have on other people. It ends up many times hurting and wounding and opening a door for Satan to work in destructive ways in people's hearts. Jesus said that all mouth talk is really heart talk. He said a tree is recognized by its fruit. For out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. The good man brings good things out of the good stored up in him, and the evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in him. But I tell you that men will have to give an account on the day of judgment for every careless word they have spoken. For by your words you will be acquitted, and by your words you will be condemned. And so your words, every last one of them, matter. Your heart comes out of your mouth every time you open it. What you say has more impact than you realize. Careless words will not be excused or rationalized. What you say will either be used for you or against you when you're judged in eternity. What we say and how we speak is used for and against God. It may be said against somebody else, but it's actually spoken against him if it's not good. It will either bear good fruit in our lives and in the lives of others, or it will bear bad fruit and lead to spiritual decay and death. Your heart affects the words that come out of your mouth, and the words that come out of your mouth affect hearts, including your own. We sometimes say, talk is cheap, but you know, talk can be costly. Your words carry weight, earthly weight and eternal weight. Solomon says, words kill, words give life. They're either poison or fruit. You choose. Bob Goff says, I used to think that words spoken about us describe who we are, but now I know they shape who we are. The words we use may not be an accurate picture of who somebody else is, or could be, but they paint the kind of person they believe they are and become. Every person who's listening to this can remember an encouraging word or a hurtful word that somebody has spoken to them, maybe years ago or even earlier today. Those words affect you, and they can still be affecting you in ways that define and shape your life. Joyce Meyer said, if someone said something very hateful and mean to me, it would affect my emotions and my mind. which would cause sadness to appear on my countenance. If someone says something uplifting and encouraging to me, it affects my mind and emotions in a positive way, putting a smile on my face. And she says, now I can feel an extra flow of energy coursing through my body. She says, we're energized by positive words and weakened by negative ones. Words can make us angry. They can calm us down. Therefore, words have power. James says, a word out of your mouth may seem of no account, but it can accomplish nearly anything or destroy it. It only takes a spark to set off a forest fire. A careless or wrongly placed word out of your mouth can do that. By our speech, we can ruin the world, turn harmony into chaos, throw mud on a reputation, and send the whole world up in smoke, and everything will go up in smoke with it. Smoke right from the pit of hell. So you're planting words every day, and they bring a harvest of either good or evil in people's lives. Your mouth is like the shovel that picks up the thoughts of your heart and buries them in somebody else's soul. And so if you continually sow negative thoughts and attitudes and words, it's going to produce many negative results in your life and the life of others. Now, everybody's responsible for what they do with the words that are spoken to them, but you're responsible for what you say to people, because it does have impact. If you sow positive, godly, loving, life-giving thoughts and attitudes and words, it's going to yield positive results. Jesus says, the words I have spoken to you are spirit and life. And if we're speaking more like Him, our words will be from His Spirit and full of life rather than harm and death. The problem is we have a tongue that keeps getting in the way. James says we get it wrong nearly every time we open our mouths. He says if you can find someone whose speech was perfectly true, you know, true all the time, right on target, you'd have a perfect person in perfect control of their life. Well, you and I have not yet met such a person. We're certainly not that perfect person. In other words, you'd be just like Jesus. Transforming your tongue requires supernatural strength. It requires God's help. Your mouth will continually reveal what is in your heart and where you may need to repent, where you may need to choose how to think and speak and allow the Spirit to convict and change your heart. Speaking like Jesus requires taking up supernatural arms, becoming, as the scripture says, strong in the Lord and the strength of His might. The psalmist says, you have tested my thoughts and examined my heart in the night. You have scrutinized me and found nothing wrong. I'm determined not to sin in what I say. So is that your purpose? To speak more like Jesus and to not sin with your mouth. The most damaging sins of life are sins of the mouth. And too many times, we don't seem to see the destructiveness of our talk. Why are we so inclined to speak about negative things or what God calls evil speech? Because we fail to see whose voice we're really listening to. Satan puts deceptive and accusing thoughts in our minds. He magnifies faults, ours and other people's. Unless you're listening to God, you're going to see what's wrong with everybody else and everything else, and that's what's going to be on your tongue. Unless you're listening to the Holy Spirit and speaking His words, you can claim to be a believer, you can claim to be a follower of Christ, and yet you're still letting the devil use your mouth. Now, it would take more than one sermon, probably years of sermons, to talk about all the ways that we sometimes allow Satan to enter our minds and misuse our mouths. But I'm only going to mention four ways that seems to happen frequently in the life of believers. One of these ways is gossip. Now, this is what the scripture says about gossip in Proverbs 26:22. The words of a whisperer or gossip are like dainty morsels to be greedily eaten. To me, it would be like having a plate full of chocolate chip cookies, and I can't wait to eat them all. They go down into the innermost chamber of the body to be remembered and mused upon. You know, we're thinking about all this negative things about people rather than thinking like Jesus about people. Gossip is a secret attack on somebody else's character. Only it's not really that secret. Because the Hebrew is whispering what is damaging. In fact, the pronunciation of a Greek word that's used for gossip begins with the sound psss. Come here, that's something I have to tell you. The juicy morsels of gossip stay with us and with the people that we gossip to. They go down on the inside, Solomon says. We muse about them. We think about them. We enjoy them. And they affect our ability to love and appreciate and hear from each other. Someone has said, great minds talk about creative ideas. Average minds talk about things. And small minds talk about people. Another person said, I hate it when people gossip about me. That's why I almost never gossip about anything unless it's really important. And then I only tell a few people. A few people. Let me tell you. I think I want to stay away from that person. Gossip is doing the devil's work of accusation while pretending to care about somebody. Beguilement, which is an older word, is the sin of passing on false conclusions. You know, making assumptions about people, talking about them, even though we have not checked them out to see whether they're true or not. It's planting seeds of mistrust or confusion. We can become like spiritual jackrabbits, jumping all over the place with wrong conclusions, wrong assumptions, while maliciously talking about people, their broken lives, leaving in our wake broken lives and damaged reputations. How often do we say something to somebody that's damaging, and we walk without even thinking anything more about it? But we've poisoned their innermost being with our words. Speaking ill of others is sort of a backhanded way of praising ourselves. We gossip instead of love. Because if we loved, we'd pray for people. And we'd speak more graciously to them and about them. When you gossip about somebody else's ungodliness, consider this. Paul says, avoid godless chatter, because those who indulge in it will become more and more ungodly. You see, you're not becoming more and more like Jesus when you gossip. You're becoming less and less like Him. You're becoming ungodly. You're becoming more like the devil. Another thing that we tend to struggle with is a critical spirit. This is closely related to gossip. Things like murmuring and complaining and a negative attitude towards others and situations. That comes from a critical spirit. Here's how James says that. He says, don't speak evil against each other, dear brothers and sisters. If you criticize and judge each other, then you're criticizing and judging God's law. But your job is to obey the law, not to judge whether it applies to you. God alone, who gave the law, is the judge. He alone has the power to save or destroy. So what right do you have to judge your neighbor? Going around and finding fault is making yourself judge and jury. And that's not your place. You're acting like God. You're taking His place. Your concern is whether you're doing what God wants you to be doing, not to be cross-examining what everybody else is doing. A spirit of criticism creates dissatisfaction and discontent. It opens the door to fill you with the same spirit that Satan has. This murmuring and grumbling and complaining and criticizing and finding fault. These are word sins. Sins that we commit with our mouth. But they reveal a far deeper problem. A heart problem. A heart that is not thankful or loving. E. Stanley Jones says, the measure of my spirit of criticism, you know, the greatness of my criticism, is the measure of my distance from Christ. A critical spirit has nothing at all in common with the Holy Spirit. And then there's foul talk. Paul addresses this issue to the Ephesians. Must have been going on in the Ephesian church. He says, "Don't use foul or abusive language. Let everything you say be good and helpful, so that your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them." And he says, "Nor should there be any obscenity, foolish talk, or coarse joking, which are out of place, but rather there should be thanksgiving." You know, it's a sad reflection on our culture, but expletives don't seem to bother us like they used to. You'll hear them practically every day on every TV show, in political speeches, and casually spoken by most people, including believers. You'll hear the D word, the A word, the H word, the S word, S-O-B, and even the F word rolling off the lips of people who claim to speak for Jesus. You know, it's like we got a foul word for every letter of the alphabet. Can you imagine Jesus Christ talking that way? There's even the J-C word, Jesus Christ. Only when it's spoken, it's not out of honor for Him. Again, it's more than just words. It's what's beneath the word. It's the attitude, full of anger, disrespect, even hateful, coming from a heart that is not honoring God. Jesus said you'll be judged by every careless word you use. These words show that we really don't care what God thinks, and we don't care about how they impact the people we express them to. We're just letting off steam, expressing our frustrations, putting others in their place, trying to control them. Foul language, you see, reveals a foul spirit, not the spirit of Jesus. And then there's lying. The psalmist says, "Keep your tongue from speaking evil, your lips from telling lies." You know, lying is the devil's language. It's his specialty. Truth is God's language, loving truth. It's the only thing he knows how to speak. You know, lying is to be in the past in our life. Paul says in Colossians 3, 9 and 10, he says, "Don't lie to each other, for you've stripped off all your old sinful nature and its wicked deeds. Put on your new nature and be renewed as you learn to know your Creator and become like Him." God does not lie. Can the same be said of you? You know, I'm a part of a group that every week when we meet, one of the questions that we ask each other and have to answer is, "Did you lie to anybody this past week, directly or indirectly?" You know, and many times it's those indirect lies that get us into trouble. You can't be a liar and a lover of the Lord at the same time. Every time you lie, directly or indirectly, you're doing the devil's work. Now, you've heard the expression, "Be careful, little ears, what you hear." Now that you're in Christ, be careful, little tongue, how you talk. If anyone speaks, let it be as one who speaks God's words, so that God may be glorified in Jesus Christ through everything. Your words should sound more and more like Jesus Christ speaking through your heart and cause His name to be glorified in you. Again, I'm not talking about being perfect, but growing more and more to speak like Him, because that shows you're growing a heart like His. Solomon says, "Dear friend, listen well to my words. Tune your ears to my voice." You know, God's speaking to you. "Keep my message in plain view at all times. Concentrate. Learn it by heart. Learn how God speaks and thinks." Those who discover these words live. They really live. Body and soul, they're bursting with spiritual health. So how can we speak more like Him? Well, one you already know about. Think before you speak. You've heard that before. Not only do we need to think more about what we're thinking about and whether it's from God, we need to think more about what we say before we say it. We can learn from Jesus, especially when others were not kind with him. Isaiah says, he was oppressed and treated harshly, yet he never said a word back. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep is silent before the shearers, he did not open his mouth. Job says, teach me, and I will hold my tongue. When you're listening to God, when your spirit is tuned to him, he teaches you what to say and what not to say, when to be quiet and when to speak up, how to talk and how not to talk. The truth is, we talk way too much, too quickly. We don't listen enough to God and people before we speak. So therefore, let every man be quick to listen, but slow to use his tongue. If anyone appears to be religious, James says, but cannot control his tongue, he deceives himself, and we may be sure that his religion is reckless. If you really want a good idea of where your heart is with God, pay attention to the words that you're speaking and how you're speaking them. Where your tongue is out of control, God is not in control of you. The words of the reckless pierce like swords, but the tongue of the wise brings healing. A reckless tongue is like a wrecking ball rather than a hopeful and healing word from God. Unless your tongue is reined in by the Holy Spirit, it's going to cause damage rather than being a healing, speaking influence for him. So how do you think about your thoughts before speaking? Well, ask yourself some questions. T, is this true? That's where it's got to start. H, is it helpful or hurtful? Now, sometimes you have to say some things that might hurt somebody temporarily, but it's more helping them than hurting them. You got to really discern the difference there. I, is it inspiring? And so even if it does have to be a little hurtful, is it inspiring? Does it encourage them? And is it necessary? K, is it kind? You see, if you can't think this way and speak this way, then you shouldn't say it. We also need to speak out of humility. We usually speak out of our own interests or our needs or our own opinions and give our own pat answers and preconceived ideas without thinking about the needs or being sensitive to the people that we're speaking to. The greatest thing that stands out about Jesus is his humility. He wasn't thinking about himself, not even once. His mind was set on you and what you needed most. He left heaven to die on a cross for you and me. He sacrificed himself for the sake of others. How often does our own pride and self-centeredness get in the way of speaking like Jesus? Philippians 2 shows us how to be humble like Jesus. Paul writes there, he says, therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, you know, these are things like the Spirit would be like, then make my joy complete by being like-minded. You know, having the mind and spirit of Jesus. Having the same love that Jesus had. Being one in spirit and one in mind, just like Jesus. He says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves. Not by looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. Let this same mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. And then Paul goes on in that chapter to talk about how Jesus humbled himself so far as to even die for us. You and I are made to reflect God's image in the world. And so how willing are you to give up yourself for the sake of others in how you speak? Jesus spoke with people out of a humble spirit. Where do you need more humility in how you treat and speak to others? And then we should speak with grace. Again, Paul writes to the churches that he had visited and helped create. He wrote to the Colossians, he says, "Let your speech always be with grace, seasoned as it were with salt, so that you will know how you should respond to each person." And then to the Ephesians, he says, "Speak the truth in love." And so we're to be truthful in a gracious way. Season your tongue with the grace of Jesus Christ. Jesus never shamed people. He never condemned people. So we're talking about speaking with love. That means loving hearts in a loving tone from a loving heart. And so when we don't speak that way, what we need to realize is there's an issue in here. I'm not speaking out of a loving heart. It's got to be in your heart before it comes out of your mouth. If you focus on unloving thoughts and feelings towards somebody, well, that's what's going to come out in your talk and probably how you treat them. When you're committed to loving God with your entire being and loving others the way Jesus loves you, that improves vastly how you speak. Paul says, if I speak with the tongues of men and angels, you know, I'm really gifted and have flowery language, but I don't love, I have become a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. You know, all your words mean nothing if they're not communicated from a loving heart. The test of your love shows up in your mouth. As one Christian teacher put it, you can say almost anything to anybody and it will be received if it is spoken in love. Seasoned with grace also means kindness. The scripture is full of reminders of how important that we speak kindly. Kind words are like honey, sweet to the soul, healthy for the body. Kind words heal and help, but cutting words, they wound and maim. Anxiety weighs down the heart, but a kind word cheers it up. Kindness is love in action. Every kind tongue is a sanctified tongue, a spirit-controlled tongue. Joyce Meyer said, if someone were to pay you 10 cents for every kind word you've ever spoken and 5 cents for every unkind word, would you be rich or poor? Mother Teresa said, let no one ever come to you without leaving better and happier. Be a living expression of God's kindness in your face, kindness in your eyes, kindness in your smile, kindness in your warm greeting. If it's not kind, it's not Christ speaking through you. And when you speak, speak gift words. I've always loved Ephesians 4:29 in the Message. Say only what helps. Each word a gift. If you can begin to get that, each word is a gift if it's spoken from God. It's a gift. I'm talking about encouragement. Our words either encourage or discourage. Vine's Dictionary of the Bible defines encouragement as to urge forward, to persuade, to comfort. When we encourage people, we give them the courage to be who God wants them to be. Spoken words of affirmation inspire people to be who they can be in Christ. It brings strength to live up to their potential in Him. The Holy Spirit is our greatest encourager. Listen to how Paul describes the work of the Spirit in our lives to the Corinthians. He says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of sympathy, of pity and mercy, and the God who is the source of every comfort or consolation and encouragement, who comforts, consoles, and encourages us in every trouble, every calamity and affliction, so that we may be able to comfort, bring consolation and encouragement to those who are in any kind of trouble or distress, with the comfort from which we ourselves are comforted and consoled by God. The most powerful instrument that you have is your tongue. Use your words to love and build people up. Every day you're relating to people who are drowning in some kind of pain, maybe even feeling hopeless. God has given you the ability to help others by pointing them to Him and what He wants to do in their lives. He gives us His words that, if used rightly in His way, will be life-changing to you and to others. Jean Nidich says that when she was a teenager, she says, I would cross the park in my neighborhood where I saw mothers were sitting together and gossiping with each other while their toddlers sat on swings with nobody to push them because the mothers were preoccupied. And so I'd give them a push. She said, do you know what happens when you push a kid on a swing? Pretty soon, he's pumping. He's doing it by himself. She says, that's what my role in life is. I'm here to give others a push forward. You know, that's why you're here too. Would you join me in prayer? Lord, I thank you for the life-giving power of your word and your words to give us hope, to lift our spirits, to encourage us in the truth, to renew and transform our minds, to nurture and impact us in positive ways, to shape our hearts, that we would have a heart like yours, that we might know how to live. Give us the ear and heart to hear what you have said to us today, to live for you in the way we talk, to not only talk the talk, but to walk with your talk, how you communicated with people, loved people, shaped the hearts and lives of people. We confess that we are often powerless over our tongues and our hearts without you. Our words often fail us and reveal where our hearts are. Give us a mouth more like Jesus had. What we're really praying, Lord, is to give us a heart more like Jesus has. Convict us of those times when we do not speak or love like Him. May the message of our mouth communicate the truth of your life in everything we say and do. We pray this in Jesus' name and by the power of His word. And we all say, Amen. Next week, we're going to be moving on and spending a couple weeks rethinking toxic thoughts. But first this.
So I know there's nothing wrong with it, but I guess situations like that just really frustrate me.
Oh, dude, no. You're totally justified in the way you feel. I mean, truth is, like that doesn't deserve a guy like you.
Thanks. It makes me feel better, I guess. I guess I just now know officially what it feels like to get, you know.
Oh, speaking of, did you hear about Jack and Maddie?
Not the whole story. I think they're just trying to keep her hush-hush. What?
Well, if that's the case, then Maggie made the greatest mistake of a lifetime by telling that chick April.
You're me.
Dude, where do you think I heard it from?
Hey! What's your problem?
How to lay that out. Watch where you're going!
Speaking of keeping your mouth shut, There's a thing on television last night about words. That the average person speaks about 18,000 words a day. Did you see that?
I think Holly had it on. I wasn't paying attention.
Yeah, but they were saying that's like over 50,000 pages in a year. That's like a whole book or something like that. But it just really made me start thinking about all the words that come out of my mouth, you know?
What a waste.
Thanks, jerk.
Hank, watch your mouth, man. Right here.
Oh, I think it's for the reminder.